results to illustrate implications of this cave compensation policy that we're all discussing over the next 2 days. So biodiversity offsets aim to reconcile development and conservation. Their ultimate goal is to achieve no net loss of biodiversity, which means that the biodiversity loss to development should equal the biodiversity that's gained through some conservation activities. Biodiversity offsets are increasingly used by government and industry all around the world to mitigate their environmental impacts. Of relevance to the mining industry, the ICMM industry body has a best practice guide on how to go about biodiversity offsetting, and many individual companies also have proactive policies of how to best undertake these projects. In response to the growing use of offsets around the world, research on this topic has also exploded over the last 15 years. This graph here talks about all of the rage of biodiversity offsets in the conservation literature, and this graph down the bottom shows a similar trend in the economics literature. So despite their growing use around the world and our growing body of knowledge about biodiversity offsets, this conservation tool remains to be really contentious. There are a whole bunch of uncertainties about how to offset, where to offset, and what the costs and benefits of doing so are. One thing, though, that we all do agree on is that biodiversity offsetting should be undertaken within what we call the mitigation hierarchy. And so what that means is that any predicted impact of a proposed project, shown here in the yellow bar, must first be avoided through changes in the project scope, then minimized wherever possible, shown in the, so the avoidance in the white bar, the minimization in the green, and then where possible, revegetation and rehabilitation activities should be used to prevent or to increase biodiversity at the landscape scale. And then finally, if there's a residual impact remaining, then biodiversity offset projects can be used to achieve this goal of no net loss. But the message here is that biodiversity offset should be considered to be a last resort to achieving the goals of, to mitigating the impacts of mining and biodiversity. So once you've quantified the amount of offsetting that's required, you have two options in terms of developing and implementing this biodiversity offset project. You can either undertake some form of revegetation or rehabilitation of degraded but ecologically significant areas so as to increase the current level of biodiversity in the landscape. This type of revegetation offsetting is really difficult for a whole number of reasons. The main one being that we're not very good at recreating nature. It's really difficult to do. The alternative to revegetation offsetting is to undertake some form of conservation activity to protect ecologically significant, again, but highly threatened ecosystems so as to avert their future loss. And it's these conservation offsets that I'm going to talk about here today. So achieving the goal of no net loss of biodiversity through the use of conservation offsets requires the offset to avert future loss that's equivalent to the loss caused by the development project. This is kind of a tricky concept to understand, so I'm going to explain it really quickly with a very simple example. Imagine a landscape in a scenario where at time one you have 4 hectares of forest. Each tree here is 1 hectare of forest. And then at time two you have 2 hectares of forest remaining. 1 hectare was cleared by mining, and 1 hectare was cleared by some other form of development. In this case, it was urbanization. A common mistake that offsetting projects make is to establish a conservation area here. They might do this because this area of forest might be easy to acquire. It might also have high biodiversity value. But the problem with offsetting in this way is that you haven't averted any future loss. The 1 hectare of forest that was cut down to establish this new mine was not equal to any loss averted by the conservation activity. In this scenario, the only place where you could establish an offset is here. And now in this case, you can see that the 1 hectare of forest lost to mining is equal to the 1 hectare of loss averted by the conservation activity. So it's these conservation offsets that are used to mitigate the impacts of mining on caves, which we all know is a legal requirement here in Brazil. I'm sure there's a large number of people in the audience that can go through the legal requirements under this policy, but these are the three big ones that will make the rest of my talk make sense. So basically what happens is that if you discover a cave, you must protect it along with its buffer zone around the must then conduct an assessment of this cave to allocate it to one of four relevance categories, based on local and regional scale, biological, geological, cultural factors. Once you've assigned your cave to one of these relevance categories, compensation requirements are then set accordingly. For maximum relevance caves, they require full protection along with their 250 meter wide buffer. High relevance caves can be removed so long as two caves that are ecologically significant are protected in its place. And low and medium relevance caves can be removed but generally also require some form of compensation. So these requirements no doubt have big, obvious implications for the mining industry, especially considering the current known extent of caves in Brazil. This map here shows all of the registered caves across the country. Some of these implications are seen here. So the requirements are seen to be expensive, both in terms of the costs that are required to undertake the surveys, and also in terms of the production that's foregone as a result of needing to conserve these caves. The requirements are also seen to be difficult to achieve. The surveys are dangerous and time-consuming. They take generally about 2 years to conduct. And compensation options are becoming increasingly limited and difficult to find because we're removing caves all the time. So I think given the context and the extent of the problem, it's worthwhile coming together and asking this question: is this policy worthwhile? Are caves actually being conserved, and what are the costs of doing so? About 2 years ago, we asked a similar question about the effectiveness of offsetting the impacts of mining to achieve no net loss of native vegetation and its biodiversity in Minas Gerais. In this study, we didn't focus specifically on cave compensation requirements, but the findings of our work do have relevance for this policy. So I'm going to present a few of the details from this study from what we found. If anyone's interested in this specific topic, please come and talk to me after the session, or I can send you this paper that we wrote about it. So this work focused on the Cordilheira do Hidro in Minas Gerais, which is arguably one of the most important iron mining regions in the world. In this map here, the areas in black, which I apologize are hard to see here, are the extent of mining operations in the year 2010, and the areas shown in gray is the current distribution of native vegetation in the region. In this region, offsetting is legally required when a mining company has both large and unavoidable impacts on native vegetation. And if the company chooses to undertake conservation offsetting to do this, here are the general requirements that are undertaken. The offset must be about 4 times larger than the impact site. It must be established as close as possible to the impact site. It must be of equal vegetation type and not currently protected under any other form of land tenure. So the question we were interested in answering was this policy and the offsets established under it working to achieve this goal of no net loss of native vegetation? To answer this question, we did a bunch of land use change modeling, which I don't want to go into the details too much, but basically what we did was these three things. I first calibrated a land use change model so as to simulate the future distribution of mining in the region. And then using this simulation and a map of vegetation, we were able to quantify the amount of vegetation that we thought would be removed over the next 20 years. With this, we were then able to, according to the current policy, we were able to determine the offsetting requirements. And we developed a second model that would allocate these offsets to the landscape, to the current protected area map. And then thirdly, what we did was we simulated future deforestation in the region undertaken by the non-mining industry, so other landholders. And in doing so, we were able to quantify the deforestation that was averted by our simulated offsets. So what we found was that mines were likely to expand and clear about 3,500 hectares of native vegetation between the years 2010 and 2020. So you can see here, this is a subsection of the Iron Quadrangle. The area in black is the mining pits in 2010, and the different shades of gray show different vegetation types. And then we simulated the most likely areas that shows you the extent and the types of vegetation that would be cleared. So this level of clearing would require about 14.2 thousand hectares of new offsets to be established in the region. And what we were able to do was to simulate this to the landscape. So the areas shown here in pink are the offsets that we expected to occur to compensate for these impacts of mining. So this is a good thing. It suggests that there's enough vegetation to undertake the offsetting. But when we simulated the deforestation that was being caused by other land users, we found that these offsets weren't achieving, they weren't averting enough vegetation loss, and as a result, weren't achieving this goal of no net loss of native vegetation. In fact, what we found was that the simulated offsets avert about 115 hectares of deforestation between the years 2010 and 2020, which is an amount equivalent to about 3% of the vegetation that was cleared by mining during this time. And just to remind you, to achieve this goal of no net loss of native vegetation, this percentage needs to be 100%. So the reason why the offsets were failing to avert equivalent loss was because they weren't being allocated to protect the region's most threatened vegetation. And you can see that in this map. So again, this is a subset of the Iron Quadrangle, and these two maps show probabilities. On the left is the probability of allocating new offsets to the landscape under the current policy, and on the right is the probability of deforestation caused by the non-mining industry in the landscape, other land users that were operating. In both cases, high probability is shown in red and low probability is shown in yellow. So what's interesting is if you compare these two maps, they're almost the inverse of each other, which suggests that the current policy is protecting the areas that are most likely to be protected as offsets are the least likely that are going to be deforested in the near future. So this occurred for two related reasons. The first was that the policy requires like-for-like offsetting, which means that if you clear ecosystem A, you're required to protect ecosystem A. The problem with that is that the mining industry was the only ones clearing ecosystem A. Every other land user was clearing ecosystem B, C, and D. So the next logical question that we thought we could ask was, would it make a difference if we allocated offsets according to this deforestation probability, if we explicitly went out and protected the most threatened vegetation in the region? And the answer was yes. Allocating the offsets to the most threatened vegetation would avert an amount of deforestation equivalent to 9% of the vegetation lost caused by mining. But again, this still isn't the 100% that would be required to achieve no net loss of native vegetation. And the reason why this alternative policy would fail is associated with this the spatial probability of deforestation. You can see that the areas in red, the most likely vegetation to be cleared, is highly dispersed across the region, which makes protecting it with a single or a few protected areas in a comprehensive way impossible. So let me just summarize what we found in this case study. We saw that the current policy wasn't achieving this goal of no net loss of native vegetation because it wasn't conserving the region's most threatened vegetation. We looked into the ability of an alternative policy to do this by allocating conservation to the region's most threatened vegetation, but we found that this still didn't achieve this goal of no net loss of native vegetation because it was really difficult to implement in a comprehensive way. So basically, what does this mean? It suggests that conservation offsets are just not a good option for mitigating the impacts of mining on native vegetation in this region, in this context. We really need to look into other options to mitigate these impacts. We need to get better at avoiding impacts before they emerge. And we need to get better at establishing revegetation offsets to be able to recreate nature with some certainty. So what does this mean for the cave compensation policy? Does it suggest that it will be successful or not? And I think ultimately the answer is it depends. And it depends on these two things. It depends on how cave dynamics and their offsetting requirements differ from those of native vegetation. And it depends on factors specifically relevant to the policy, how it's interpreted and implemented. And I'm going to talk just quickly through these two independent categories. So there are so many ways in which caves differ from native vegetation. here are the two that I think that are really important to understand. Firstly, there are so many caves that remain undiscovered, and we're discovering new ones all the time. What this means is that we don't know the full extent of all of our compensation options, which makes strategic landscape-wide conservation planning really difficult, if not impossible. The other implication is that of discovering new caves all the time is that it's affecting potentially the relevance of already known caves and potentially changing the requirements of caves that are already compensated for. The second way in which caves differ from native vegetation is that they're not recreatable. You can't remove a cave and then recreate a cave somewhere else like you could possibly do with a tree. So what this means is that revegetation offsets just aren't an option in this case, and conservation, if we're going to talk about offsets, is the only option. There are also many, many other factors associated with the policy itself that will affect whether we can call this policy a success or not. And I'm going to talk about three. The first is that the policy appears to have really unclear goals at the moment, which means that it's impossible to know what constitutes success. For example, if the goal of the policy is to reduce the rate at which caves are being lost, then potentially it will be successful because the process, the policy itself of assessing caves and conserving them is so complicated and so time-consuming that we are actually reducing the rate at which they're being lost at the moment. However, if the goal is to achieve this no net loss of biodiversity, then we know that the outcome will be dependent on our ability to avert future loss, which my work in the Iron Quadrangle shows is really difficult in a mining context. Another factor that's likely to affect success is that at the moment, the interpretation and implementation of this policy differs on a project-to-project basis for a whole number of really real reasons. So, the terminology is really subjective at the moment in the policy, and the surveys themselves are relying on untested methods because they're new. And so with every new survey, the methods are being updated because we're learning things about these caves and what they mean all the time. And then thirdly, there's been a lot of talk about the costs of these compensation requirements being a real limiting factor in being able to achieve the goals of the policy. But I think it would be really interesting to understand further when these costs are incurred and to whom are incurring the costs, and to look into whether if we had the full set of information before the planning process, could we mitigate the fact that there'll be surprise costs along the way. So this is my final slide. I just want to summarize everything that I've said today, and then hopefully we can have a discussion and about what this means. So biodiversity offsets are being used all around the world to mitigate the impacts of mining, and here in Brazil they're being used to mitigate impacts on caves. But given their current implications of achieving their requirements and also the extent of the problem, I think it makes sense to ask this question: are these policies worthwhile? Are caves actually being protected, and what are the costs of doing so? I presented some evidence from a case study in Minas Gerais, which suggests that conservation offsets weren't mitigating the impacts of mining on native vegetation because they weren't protecting the region's most threatened vegetation, and even changing where we put them wasn't achieving this goal either. New methods are needed. Offsetting is not a good idea. In terms of what this means for cave compensation policies here in Brazil, well, I think it depends. It depends on the way in which caves and native vegetation differ in their dynamics and their offsetting requirements, and it depends on how the policy is undertaken and implemented on the landscape. So I think in terms of looking to the future and actually coming to a solution about what we can do here, is we really need to undertake this system-wide mapping of caves. It's the only way that we'll be able to undertake a strategic landscape
ahead of time. So it means we have plenty of time for questions. So the floor is open. Don't forget to introduce yourself, whoever is the speaker.
Hi, are you talking in Portuguese? Please, could you use the phone?
Sim, só fala o seu nome, né?
Meu nome é Éder, eu trabalho em Carajás, né, sou engenheiro de minas. Então, são duas perguntas, né? Duas perguntas, e a primeira é um comentário também. Eu trabalho em Carajás há 5 anos, né? E nesse tempo a gente já tiveram cavidades que passaram de máxima relevância para alta relevância, a gente conseguiu compensação de algumas, né? Então, assim, esse processo de estudo ele é contínuo, né? E volta e meia cavidades caem de relevância, e quando algumas caem, outras podem subir também, né? E assim, o meu comentário é quanto à questão econômica. Nós estamos falando de desenvolvimento sustentável, né? Então, a queda de uma cavidade, ela implica num valor econômico para a empresa, e tem diferenciação de tipos de cavidades que impactam em determinado valor econômico. Algumas prendem bilhões de dólares e outras prendem alguns milhões, né? Então, assim, meu comentário é se esse valor econômico de cada uma das cavernas poderia ser levado em conta na classificação de priorização de lavra dessas cavernas, tendo em vista que como o processo é contínuo de estudo, isso pode evoluir, e parte desse valor econômico gerado pelas cavernas, que tem um grande valor econômico, ele pode ser revertido em pesquisa, né? Poderia ser alguma possibilidade para esse assunto. Eu gostaria de saber o que você acha disso, né? Sobre esse impacto econômico das cavernas, se isso poderia ser levado em conta. E a outra questão é que Carajás a gente tem mostrado grandes evoluções, né, em lavra, em regiões de cavidades, onde a gente tem impacto em raio, chegando próximo do raio das cavidades, sem impactar, né, na estrutura da cavidade, sem impactar na biodiversidade que está ali presente, né? Então, assim, esses 250 metros de raio de proteção, se tu acredita que isso não precisa de mais estudos para provar que realmente são 250 metros que precisam ser preservados, ou se pode ser menos, né? Então, como tem que preservar 250 metros da cavidade, né, e tu projeta um cone para baixo, cada cavidade prende determinada quantidade de reserva. Existem cavidades que estão no meio da mina, realmente. Então, assim, elas prendem uma grande quantidade de reserva. São milhões de toneladas, que representam bilhões de dólares, né? E outras cavidades, elas ficam nas bordas da mina.
Even base this assessment on science. So I think I have colleagues trying to quantify this, the required area. So that would be really important research. In terms of the loss of the cave to the profits of the mining industry, I think that I think we need to decide on what the goals of the policy are. If it's to preserve caves at the national scale, then I think that and we're running out of mitigation options, running out of compensation options, then we need to have a discussion about that, about what the values of people are, whether they're to extract minerals for the benefits of people now, or whether it's to conserve a cave for future generations. Because at the moment we're making this trade-off between what we want now and what we won't have in the future. But yeah, there are a lot of really important issues, and I think we need to have this conversation.
Thank you. Mais perguntas? Temos ainda um bom tempo. Cleiton.
Alô? Cleiton Lino, Reserva da Biosfera da Mata Atlântica e Sociedade Brasileira de Espeleologia. É mais um comentário, assim, mas que aí em cima dele, se você quiser também comentar, agradeço. Primeiro que a questão dos 250 ou 300 metros de entorno de proteção da caverna, na legislação que coloca que esta, 250 metros, é a distância mínima de proteção e até que sejam feitos estudos que indiquem qual que deve ser, qual é a área de influência. Ou seja, ela pode ser menor, inclusive os colegas da Vale, eu tive lá em Carajás, etc., estão fazendo estudos assim, do ponto de vista de sísmica, a questão das explosões, e, em alguns casos, já viram que, naquela situação específica, em algumas cavernas específicas, é provável que não precisasse dos 250 metros para prever o impacto do ponto de vista sísmico. Não sabemos, do ponto de vista biológico, por exemplo, se tem algum outro ruído ou coisa tal assim. Mas esses são estudos que estão sendo feitos. Mas, ou seja, pode ser menos. E pode ser que seja necessário muito mais. Pode ser que a zona de amortecimento, a zona de influência, tenha que ser 1 quilômetro, 2 quilômetros, dependendo da situação. É que nós temos uma tendência no Brasil a dizer o que é mínimo passa a ser a lei. Então, não é 250 metros, eu queria só reforçar isso. 250 metros é uma precaução quando não existem os estudos. E agora, só agora que os estudos estão sendo feitos em várias bases que então vão nos permitir ter uma ideia melhor nesse caso.
Would you like to comment?
Yeah, I think we need the science. Yeah, and I think the mining companies have a great opportunity to build on our knowledge at the moment of what's required. I think another interesting point is that we're talking just at the moment about the buffer zones and what's required, which we don't know about yet. But another thing that I have colleagues working on is whether we need to create corridors that link caves together so that we have this like habitat, yeah. So the landscape ecology comes into it.
A área de influência está mais relacionada ao empreendimento, até onde o empreendimento pode impactar aquilo, né? Até onde ele poderia ir. Né? Se a gente for pensar um desmonte de rocha, se for feito manual, para chegar na porta da caverna. Não é essa a situação. Né? A situação é o meu empreendimento, aonde ele impacta. Um empreendimento, dependendo da tipologia do empreendimento, ele poderia estar a montante ou a jusante da caverna, ele poderia impactar ou não a caverna. Né? Eu acho que é esse raciocínio, essas são as pesquisas, para isso que as pesquisas estão levando, que que eu acho que é a oportunidade de, quando da revisão das legislações, ser considerado isso. Né? A área de influência da caverna em si, para mim, era um momento que a gente estava, a época onde isso foi definido. Comprovadamente, os 250 metros não funcionam. Não são efetivos em absolutamente caso nenhum, nem para mais nem para menos. Né? É um número cabalístico que foi colocado e que ele não tem levado assim, nem ao empreendimento, nem à conservação da caverna, na prática. Né? Só uma observação.
Obrigado.
Português. Bom, sou Maria Nina, sou da Universidade Federal de São Carlos, trabalho com fauna de cavernas. Essa questão da área de influência, eu acho que tudo isso vai se resolver quando a gente começar a tratar na nossa legislação que cavernas estão numa paisagem. É muito simples. Para a biologia, apesar da biologia ser extremamente complicada, é muito difícil eu dizer o que é uma espécie e o que não é. Eu posso usar as técnicas moleculares que o Harvey mostrou muito bem aqui, ou as morfologias, ou as populações que são muito variáveis, que são clinais e blá blá blá. Mas é muito claro para a gente que as cavernas estão em uma paisagem, os landscapes. A partir disso, para cada situação, eu posso ter áreas de influência totalmente diferentes. Eu dependo de recargas fundamentais que estão alimentando esses rios subterrâneos que abrigam uma fauna única, como o sistema Areias, a nossa principal caverna no Brasil, com maior número de troglódios, extremamente raros e importantes. Ou, no caso dos minérios de ferro, que são extremamente particulares, eu não trabalho muito com cavernas de minério de ferro, estou conduzindo um projeto recentemente, monitorando algumas cavernas, projeto particular, de um desafio realmente para mim. E nesse sentido, o que eu observei ali? A dinâmica é outra, totalmente distinta. Ali, para eu definir uma área de influência, é muito mais complicado. É tudo conectado por pequenos canais. E eu não consigo imaginar como eu posso revegetation, ou propor uma nova paisagem. Eu trabalho também um pouco com cerrado. O cerrado é impossível plantar novamente. O cerrado tem caules subterrâneos que eu não vou plantar novamente. Eu não tenho quase banco de sementes de cerrado no Brasil. Não existe investimento para isso. O cerrado é único e é no cerrado brasileiro que eu tenho as principais nascentes de rios que abastecem populações. Então, eu acho que a gente vai ter uma discussão longa, árdua aqui. Eu acho que essa tendência de achar o que é o mínimo e o que é o máximo, tanto para cavernas, relevâncias máximas, ou altas, ou médias, ou baixas, né? Amanhã eu vou falar um pouco sobre isso. Eu acho muito complicado imaginar que uma caverna pode cair de relevância máxima para alta. Eu não sei o que aconteceu ali, mas isso... Fiquei preocupada em ouvir isso, né? O que é péssimo realmente para o empreendedor, e o que é péssimo para a fauna também e para o próprio meio físico que abriga essa fauna. Então, gente, as cavernas estão lá, elas não podem ser dissociadas da paisagem. Elas fazem parte de um processo de milhões ou bilhões de anos. É graças a essa rocha que se transformou em solo que eu tive, em temperismos e possibilidades de vegetação, que eu tive a ocorrência de faunas únicas que vieram, extinguiram, colonizaram, isolaram. Pronto, as áreas de influência, eu acho que essa discussão, ela tem que se considerar a ciência, como você disse, o init science, realmente, mas que ciência? Cada caso vai ser um caso. Então, a área de influência, para mim, quando uma caverna tem um rio, é uma. Quando uma caverna é mais seca, não às vezes totalmente seca, porque tudo ali tem influência de água, no passado, pelo menos, vai ser outra. Então, a gente tem que considerar essas paisagens. Eu acho que a ecologia de paisagens, o dia que ela for realmente colocada na nossa instrução normativa, a gente vai ter condição realmente de discutir se uma caverna entre algum nível de relevância para os termos biológicos e físicos também. Porque agora a gente tem os geossistemas, né? Todas essas considerações. É só uma reflexão, realmente, não é uma pergunta. Eu concordo com você que precisamos de ciência. Eu fico imaginando, é um desafio muito grande essa sua ideia, seu projeto, o seu trabalho, eu parabenizo, mas a gente tem que levantar a bola para as paisagens. A gente tem que proteger o mosaico de paisagens. Não estou falando para proteger tudo. Lógico que boa parte vai ser suprimida, mas a gente tem que considerar que mosaico eu quero conservar. E é esse o desafio para o futuro do Brasil. Que a gente tem mosaico. O Cerrado não é um bioma, o Cerrado é um mosaico de vegetação. Mata Atlântica é mosaico, Floresta Amazônica é mosaico. E ali estão inseridas diversas cavernas, né? Então a gente tem que considerar isso. Pantanal. Tá?
Yeah, sure.
I think that point about understanding all of your options when you're undertaking conservation is a really important one. I think that all this discussion about how important the buffer is itself is really important as well, to make sure that the compensation activity is being undertaken. But I think maybe what's a bigger issue is taking a step back and thinking about how many caves you want in Brazil in the end. Because at the moment, we're going to run out of caves to compensate with, right? There's a certain number of caves, and you can't go on compensating forever. So I think we really need to think about what we want the landscape to look like in the future, how many caves, what type of caves, and then talk about how do you actually undertake the methods to conserve those areas long term, which will be about understanding the landscape ecology, understanding the biodiversity, understanding how species move across the landscape. Yeah, a lot of issues.
Thank you. We have time for one more question.
Again, with another Tarzan, speleobiologist or biospeleologist, that depends. Just a comment. I think that the big issue is not exactly this, but to consider the cave as a unit. Cave is not a biological unit, so we need to change this focus. We need to go to the, in terms of biology, we need to move on. And because that depends. If you're looking at the aquatic fauna, maybe you should consider the system. We need a systemic vision. For the terrestrial fauna, that depends. Maybe you should look at the outcrop. We should focus on connectivity. For bats, what we have studied this, and bats use in some areas with a high concentration of caves, bats use caves as a group. We have itinerant colonies. So usually they will use a group of caves, not one cave. So you have to consider those this group of caves as a unity. And this is the unit to study and to establish the in-place area. So we have to move on. We have to change our conception, our definitions of caves. And we also have to detail a little bit more our definition of biodiversity. What is diversity? It's not only the number of species. It includes a lot of other things that I think we'll have time to discuss this tomorrow. But it's not one species by another species. It's not one cave by another cave. It's not, and that's the problem with the legislation. The legislation is completely insufficient. And the fact that there are caves, there are still caves that go, that move along this, this scale of relevance. It's a clear indication that there is something very wrong with this normative.
Yes.
They should not be moving so easily. They should be, the problem is that studies are, the studies that are predicted by these norms, these regulations, they are not sufficient. That's it.
I think that's a really good point about not thinking about them in terms of units, because at the moment we're finding, again, colleagues of mine in Brazil are finding that caves that are being removed and then their compensation partners actually are part of the same system. So you're not really compensating, you're degrading one half of a cave and protecting the other half, which isn't really averting any loss like